Good evening, viewers, and welcome again to Discovering Truth. And I am Pastor Forbes from Abiding Word Ministries. We're just a few days away from celebrating the Gambia at 52, our 52nd anniversary as a nation. And I know this one is going to be super special because of what it entails to us. We have a new president, and there's a whole lot of goodwill that we are all looking forward to. And so I want to take this opportunity to invite us all. There's going to be a mega praise and a worship and a Thanksgiving night at Abiding Word Ministries at our premises in Bakau, the Gateway, on the 19th of February. That's the Sunday after Independence Day, from 7 in the evening right through nonstop to 11 p.m. All kinds of groups from all different churches and music groups are just going to come, and together we will all thank God, worship God, because really, whatever we say, the only person, the only being that's worthy of any praise and glory in all that changed our ampas into what we have now is God. The wisdom that people had, the negotiation skills, whatever happened, the ability to concede and give up and all that, we have to give God the glory for it. Because sometimes man erroneously beats his or her chest thinking that I have done it, it's my skill, it's how wise I am. But because we all understand that our breath is on lease from God, we do not own our lives, we did not create ourselves, some things can look so good to us and then they turn out bad, and some things can look so impossible and they turn out good. There are many people who knew for a fact that the Gambia came to the very brink of civil unrest, war, or something, and it just all fizzled out as if it never happened. And because of the demographics of our country, people who went out for safety were able to come in a short time. And as we think about it, there is no evidence of people drowning in the river, the ferry was loaded and doing so many routes up and down. There's really not much we can say that was tragic, and we need to be able to give God thanks for that. So Abiding Word Ministries and many other churches are coming. The names we all know in worship, in praise, music groups are all coming together on the 19th of February, Sunday evening from 7 p.m. right through 11, just a night of thanking God and thanking him for all he has done for us. I also really want to say that I was personally pleased when I was able to watch President Adama Barrow and President Sadauda Jaura sitting together and talking. Of course, they are generations apart, but it brought such peace and joy into our hearts, because I remember saying that one of the things that I prayed for was that President Jaura would live to see this, and we are sure that he will be invited for the independence celebration and the public inauguration of President Adama Barrow. And it would show us that the baton can be handed properly and people can leave. And I hope the lesson we all learn is that when opportunity knocks on our door, we take it and don't become intransigent, so that what we can otherwise gain, we lose historically. Because it could have been three presidents sitting together, and unfortunately, it was only two. And we need to be able to understand when time and opportunity call us to be magnanimous, so that posterity judges us properly. Thoughts in my mind tonight and possibly next Tuesday, even though I have a Valentine message, since it's going to be a few days. I think it's actually going to be Valentine's Day next Tuesday. And so I want to talk about the languages of love. But tonight my mind goes on good governance, and I'll just share my thoughts with you. For those of us who follow football, and people who know me well will tell you that I only support two teams in the world, soccer. One of them is Cameroon. And so you need to ask my wife how joyful I was when Cameroon equalized and then scored in the last minute of the 90-minute time limit to lift up the Cannes Trophy in Gabon. But before the final match, a statement their coach made that I felt is important and can be related to as I speak tonight, was he said that these players, there were 23 of them, and they were young, from about 18, 19 to 23, 24. He said he has never coached a team of 23 friends. He said they were friends. They were not just football players. It was not just somebody trying to score a goal because some scout from Europe is around there watching to see. But they were friends. You know, they had their dance. They joked together. We saw them pranking around when the bus came, brought them for the final match, because they were friends. Now, that presupposes some amount of togetherness based on certain commonalities. And so in my mind, as I think of good governance for our nation, what we might be calling the Third Republic if our constitution goes through some kind of amendment, that President Adama Barrow and his team of people who will lead this nation, I'm not too sure whether we can call them a dream team, because they're probably going to be made of old and new, young and old. But there are some thoughts in my mind. And the first one is that I believe that God, and nobody else, God pressed the reset button for our nation. He rebooted, he recalibrated after some updates. And that's why we are seeing the kind of, true peace, and not just manufactured peace, true peace and happiness and so many things going on in the country at the same time, and people can exhale, and a lot of people are airing their views, you know, and nobody's looking down their shadows. Probably a few people who have committed crimes are wondering what will happen to them, but it's just a togetherness. Now, for that to be taken forward, there are a couple of things that I think are crucial, and tonight I would be able to speak maybe on three, and I will call them the three C's. Now, before I get to that, there is one scripture in the Bible, in the book of Amos, Prophet Amos in the Old Testament, and in chapter 3 and verse 3, Amos chapter 3 verse 3 goes something like this, that two people cannot walk together except they are in agreement. You would be unwise, you will be self-destructing if you bring on your team people who, by either who they are or something surrounding them, disqualifies the team from being able to give its best, because you're always going to be doing damage control and rejoinders here and there. And so Jesus Christ said through the lips of Prophet Amos that two people cannot walk together except they be in agreement. It happens in a church, it happens in a bank, it happens in a football team, it happens for a marriage. If the two are not together, they cannot walk together. They are probably looking out of two different windows, seeing two different things, which are realities for both of them, but there is no synergy and they do not synchronize. So therefore, there is no one purpose, there is no one goal, the targets are different. And so for two people to walk together, it says they must be in agreement, which means there must be some basic commonalities between them somewhere in their vision, in their mission, in their core values, in their sense of objective and goals. And there's got to be something that brings them together. And when we talk about nationhood, nation building, and the state, we're going to go beyond many things which might be okay in themselves, but they're disqualifying factors. The second scripture in my mind before I give you these three things, after Amos 2:2, is the second gospel in the New Testament, Mark. It's actually in Matthew, Mark, and in Luke, where Jesus Christ said, he himself said, you cannot take a piece of new cloth and try and sew it and join it to old cloth, because when you wash them, one is going to shrink, and after shrinking, there'll be a tear, because the two cloths cannot be in agreement. They cannot walk. There is something that disqualifies the old cloth from coming to the new cloth, and there is something in the new cloth that just makes it not possible for it to synergize with the old cloth. So the first thing Jesus Christ said, he said, you cannot join old cloth and new cloth together. Then secondly, he says, you cannot put new drink or new wine into an old wine bottle. It says new wine skin, old wine skin, sorry. A wine skin is like, you know, the rubber we used to take to fetch water from the wells. that black rubber, it's something like that. It's a wine. When it's old, maybe the sun has hit it, it's able to crack. So when you put the new thing into it, its tensile strength, its stretchability is old. That cracks will coming, and Jesus Christ said two things will happen. Of course, the old wineskin breaks and the new wine dissipates. So we lose. In my days, they would say nyaka this, nyaka les tek. You lose. And so when we are thinking of good governance, and I know there are experts in this field, but I believe we all have a stake to say something in the direction of our nation, at least to a government that seems to be listening, hopefully. And so the first thing in my mind is that in these three C's, if I were looking for my team of agreement, if I were looking for the cloth that will fit the other cloth, if I were looking for the wineskin that will carry my wine or the wine that will fit in my wineskin and there's no destruction, the first thing I'm going to look for is called character. There are three C's and the first one is character. Simply defined or described, character is who you really are inside of you. As we always teach, character and reputation are different. Your reputation is what people know of you outside. So it's the people who know you inside, the people who live with you, the people who grew up with you, the people who knew you before you became popular or notorious or celebratory. They know your character. It's your really makeup. Do you lie? Do you steal? Do you cheat? Do you tell the truth? Are you punctual? Are you humble? You know, are you bigoted? Are you vindictive? Your true character. And character takes time to build. It's not just your impressions or your packaging, it is your content. And character is built over time. It is tested. It is almost, if you like, universally proven. Character is a product that delivers on its name, regardless of where it is. You are in China, it will deliver. You know, a crook in Gambia will not be a crook in America, will not be a crook in Venezuela or a crook in Japan. Because its character is who you are. Your word is your bond. Your no is your no. Your yes is your yes. I cannot is I cannot. I will come, I will come. Forgive me is forgive me. I owe you, I owe you. And I really think that much as these three C's, and there could be more, the three C's I want to zero in, each one of them is rated very highly. But I want to really say that for me, I believe that in any sphere of an endeavor, of work, of team effort, character is important. Because you see, when you have people of character, you don't have to second guess them. Does he really mean what he's saying? Is she speaking the truth? Because when you do not have character, things pop up along the line and they become decoys, distractions to the goal, to the mission, to the purpose. And of course, as we are addressing our own nation, if the coalition MOU is what it is, and I believe they are going to stick to it because they have to, because it's character again. 3 years is a short time, it's 36 months. Almost a month of that 36 has gone. Actually, almost 2 months has gone. So it's 34 months. And therefore, you cannot have a team where there are obvious, glaring character flaws that are going to make the wheels of progress slow or slow. The other thing about this thing is that, you know, your character haunts you in the future. That's just the sad thing about life. It pops up again and again. And so C1, in terms of working together, C1, in terms of pushing the vision of this transition government, of making the Gambia what it is, and we've seen a lot of reversals taking place from the kind of life we were forced to live. We are happy and that's the framework we want to have. But the people who are core to this drive must be a people of character. Not reputation. You know, reputation is funny. If you take a census of reputation, there are people who will say Pastor Forbes is good. I'm pretty sure there are people who will say Pastor Forbes is bad. That's just reputation. And, you know, because we can all, you know, put on a package, you know. Somebody is very, very mean, but he just chooses to look good and he can reinvent and rebrand himself or herself. But you see, your character will show up wherever you are. It will show up wherever you are. It's like when we talk about a dog, you know, or a pig. Sometimes people say you can take a pig and, you know, a dog and give them a good wash, scrub them, put some deodorant on them, put cologne on them. But when you leave them, give them 5 minutes, you're going to see them in a place that is diametrically opposed to what you had just done to them, because their character takes them somewhere. Somebody said this: your reputation and your gift sometimes takes you to a place in terms of hierarchical height, but what keeps you at that place without your tumbling down is your character. If you are used to seeing $20 on a table and you don't touch it, and you are used to seeing $200 on a table and you don't touch it because it's not yours, you didn't put it there, when you see 4,000, very like you won't touch it, because character is built. It becomes second nature. It's part of your DNA. It becomes a resolve. It becomes, for lack of a better word, a pride in you. You will be hungry, but you won't steal. But if you don't have character and you have a propped up reputation and a propped up makeup and packaging, wow. Nations wonder why such amount of squandering by one person, two people. It's character. The second C that I believe is important is competence. And by the way, before I go to competence, let me say that for each one of us, nobody knows when the door is going to be open to you or the call is going to come to you to serve in a character-based place for your nation. Therefore, I make this phrase: build your character first before you build your nation. A lot of people rush. They want to take ministerial posts. They want to do this, sit on boards because they feel it's their turn by tribe or by this or by that. If your character is not there, you're not going to be any better than the person who was there before you. You know, and it's amazing. It's like in the dying days of the Second Republic, it was interesting to see character flaws, you know, people who were jumping to take ministerial positions and people who were doing things because it was always in them. That greed was always in them. And so whether it was one-day minister, three-day minister, four-day MP, whatever, they jumped to it. It's a character flaw. And sometimes the truth is that it's disrespect to yourself and dishonor to your family. And so we build our character first before we build our nation. In the Bible, when David was given a particular battle fatigue to go to war to fight Goliath, it was great. It was actually what the king used. So it was top of the line. When he wore it, he couldn't move in it. So rather than go and try to be who he was not and be killed by the giant, he told them, I'm going to take this thing off. I cannot use it. I have not proven or tested it. It's not me. This is not me. This is not me. And so character is important. The second thing I believe for a proper functional governance structure and to build a dream team is competence. It's competence. Competence, simply put, is ability. Is capacity, is skills, is training, is expertise, is experience. You cannot fake competence. You know, you can write anything on your CV, but when you go for the interview, you can't defend it. And when you start doing the work, you can't do the work because you are not competent, you are not able, you are not capable, you are not skilled, you are not experienced in it. You haven't worked in this area so much that you can tell. And when that happens, the problem with that is, okay, I have a few skills in my life, but let me take something like, I don't know what I can say. Let me say you asked me to be a history teacher. or you asked me to maybe run a bank. Now, I have no skills in that area. I'm sure when I start running that bank, in a short few years, the bank will fold up because everybody will see that I do not know about this banking and they will be taking monies and I will not know because I am not skilled and trained in that area to be able to tell the loopholes, the blind spots, the games, and the tricks. I'll just feel that I am the MD. I'm signing, I'm stamping, I'm going on conferences, I'm having bonuses, I'm being invited to Kairaba, I'm invited to State House, to Cocoa Ocean, you know, I'm going to the airport, and it's like everybody will be rich over my head because I'm incompetent in that field. And that is why we have this phrase in English that you do not put round pegs in square holes, or you do not put square pegs in round holes. They don't fit. And no matter how you force it, there are some, you either have to break something, destroy some things, or there are gaps. And so in building a good governance dream team for our republic and leaving it as a benchmark legacy for the next republic, if it should come, is we need competent people. People proven, tried, and tested. I have somebody very close to me, family-wise, who used to crack this joke with me that every time they're in their office, somebody will just knock on the door and say, "Ki mama yonichio, this person sent me to you." And so after some time, this person had a folder in their office of people who had CVs that they could call upon if they had a vacancy, short-term or long-term, in their company, and had another folder entitled "Ki mama yonisio." You know, so your uncle says, "Go to this person." Your auntie says, "Go to this person." And when the person opens the door, even "Ki mama yonichio," it's not even English. So when you ask them questions, it's like, wow. So that is gross incompetence. And everybody and anybody and whatever mindset has been in us that makes that happen, for whatever reason, I think we should really come out of that, because it's not a win-win situation. If I should run a company and bring even my family members who cannot do anything in that company but keep them as my family members, I'm shooting myself in the foot. Because for starters, to sack them will be difficult because it's family. To take them to court or jail will be difficult, it's family. And so we need competence. And this is not just for the government of the Gambia, for every franchise and every enterprise, parastatals, private, for all that we do, it's competence, because competent people drive your vision forward. Competent people are able people, they are smart people, they are experienced people, they are capacitized, they are capable, they can do it. They are also willing. And because of who they are, they also have a component within them that allows for trainees to come up so that those ones can be capacitized too, because competent people don't sit there until they die. And that's why Jesus said you can't mix old and new. You're going to lose both, because thinkings are different. If the way things are going, we're probably going to start a third republic as it's being touted, maybe when the constitution is changed. And so First Republic and Third Republic are 22 years removed from each other. Very likely, if I remember well, when the First Republic ended, there were no iPhones. I think mobile phones just started. Look at what we have now. Look at technology. So we have to balance competence, especially into new technology. In the first gospel of the Bible, Matthew, in chapter 25, I have spoken about this severally. Jesus Christ gave a parable about a man who was going to a far country and called his servants and gave them assignments. And it says he gave them talents, each one according to their ability. And that's how it should be, not according to their tribe, not even according to their gender. Sometimes in political life, there's a place for gender balance, but what are we going to do if there are going to be 17 positions and all of them can be competently filled? across the board by one gender. What do we have at the back of our mind? Is it to move the nation forward so everybody enjoys, or is it to play like what one nation calls federal character games? Two from here, one from there, one from there. I would rather posit that a nation that is merit-driven, a company that is merit-driven than tribe and all these other considerations driven, will go far. And so Jesus Christ said, this man called his servants, he called them, and he knew them. So he gave them gifts according to their ability. One was given five, one was given two, the last one was given one. And as if you follow that scripture in Matthew chapter 25 of the Bible, this is verse 14, the two and the five did what they could do and the one couldn't. So competence is important. The third thing, and I'll end with that, is chemistry. There must be a team that gels. There's a chemistry. They complement. They don't compete. They don't undermine. They work together. And so for us to have like a dream governance team to move the Gambia forward, it needs to be a team that works together. So it has to be a team of people of character, people of competence, and people of chemistry. People like the Cameroonian team who are friends, people who can work together, not people who are undermining each other, because party politics was over on the 2nd of December, maybe until we get to National Assembly elections. But my little take for all the people who will serve in the executive, possibly the legislature, and the judiciary, just the three arms of government, if we look at these three C's, we won't be wrong. Are they people of character? Are they competent? And do they have the chemistry? Because if people don't have chemistry, they will undermine you. His Excellency President Adama Barrow will say one thing, and then maybe another minister is saying another thing. And the chemistry is not there. And when people are not together, they are not united. And when they are not united, they are divided. And when they are divided, they fall. Let me leave these three with us. By the grace of God, I'll continue next week, or we'll talk about the languages of love, even for your business, even for our homes, for all that we do, relationships. Look for character, look for competence, look for chemistry. I'm almost sure that I can guarantee you that you won't be wrong. And God will help us as a nation. Until I come our way next week, by the grace of God, let's all have a great evening. We're looking forward to independence on Saturday the 18th and Sunday the 19th, 7 p.m. at Abiding Word. That'll be an awesome worship time. We are all just going to say thank you to God from 7 in the evening till 11 for all that God has done for us, because God intervened in the Gambia. God bless you and good night.